from Chennai University. Further, he did his LLB from Uspa University. And then he has done his PG diploma in patents law from NALSA, Hyderabad. He is a qualified company secretary and is a fellow of the Institute of Company Secretaries of India. Besides this, he also holds a PG diploma in computer science. He has done his past professional examination conducted by the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. He has put in more than 31 years of service and he has been associated with chartered accountants for clarifying doubts on GST in various video conferences. Besides this, he is a regular faculty at Sitara and several training institutes based in Hyderabad. He is also a visiting faculty at IITM. We are indeed fortunate to have him with us for sharing his ideas and clarifying our doubts regarding GST. It's an important subject for all those who are dealing with the passing of bills and day-to-day working in their offices. Thank you. Over to Mr. Krishna Kumar.
along with that particular RR, when we are issuing
the GST rate becomes 18%. For instance, when we actually levy license fees, we collect 18% from them. Now, all these amounts will become our output tax liability. Money, hum jo paisa vasool karte hain, jo the amounts which we are realizing, that is the GST element which we are realizing from the recipients of railway services, that is transportation service, will come under this category of output tax liability which we are due to pay to the government. Then you should ask one question immediately. What happens to this input taxes which we are paying? What is input here? Jaisa naam bata raha na, input hai. Apne service render karne ke liye jo inputs hai, hum log us inputs ko lene ke liye hum log tax bhar dete hain. Isko tax bhar dete hain, we pay to the suppliers of that service. When they are suppliers of service ya goods, see, hum log kya kya kharidte hain, we purchase steel, rails purchase karte hain, we purchase cement bhi purchase karte hain, sleepers purchase karte hain, catenary wire purchase karte hain. Ye pura hum log jab purchase karenge, the tax for that will become your input tax for making the particular service. Now, what is the liability of railways basically? Now, output services, hum log transportation services jo kare, usme se hum log input tax credit jo hai, usko kata ke, hum log we will be arriving at what is the GST to be paid to the government. This is a fundamental concept, and we should all be aware of why and how the GST is being paid. Now, where are we getting all this data from? It is very important to know from where are we getting this data. Output tax liability data we are getting from 7 systems. I think I have mentioned it in the PPT also. You can see it here. OIS, UTS, PRS, PMS, IIPS, CRIS or IPAS. Now, some of you will be wondering why IPAS. Gentlemen, IPAS ko kyun include kare? Question aa jata hai na tumhe. So, why I have included IPAS in JVs bhi hum log dalte hai IPAS. Jab JVs dalte hai, in certain cases, you have to transfer the amount from your deposit edge to the earnings. When you transfer the amount from the deposit heads to the earnings, for instance, penalties collected for license transactions, all these will definitely come under GST. Liquidated damages, which we collect from suppliers, where there are delays in supplies and all those areas, automatically GST becomes applicable for such transactions. When you have such sort of transactions which are recorded in the form of JVs, IPAS also becomes a source for your input-output tax liability. You have to account that in your offline CRIS manual utility. Now, this is as far as the basic concept of how GST is paid on railways is concerned. In the next thing, I try to explain to you how input tax credit is arrived at. Input tax credit, generally, all our expenses is captured in only one system, that is our IPAS. Now, IPAS mein jo bhi capture hota hai, hum log jo bhi bill pay karte hain, you have a basic number called the invoice number. The invoice number and the date of invoice are the primary records as far as GST is concerned. So, we should capture that number very carefully. हम लोग ये भी देखें कि जब भी आप invoice number capture करना चाहते हैं तो एक तो bill number होता है और दूसरा invoice number अलग होता है. So, what has happened is in GST you have a primary condition that the supplier should remit the GST paid by railways to the government. This is a primary condition in section 16. So, when you have this primary condition that 91 to 98. You've got the mistake. It's an 8-digit code. And this code will start from 01 to 98. For services rendered, it starts with 99 only. It starts with 99. So what you do is you actually identify, you are in the position to identify whether goods have been supplied or services have been supplied. And the rates will differ on what type of goods have been supplied and what type of services have been supplied. You have the rate list also available. Now here, please understand that the responsibility for actually giving the correct HSN code or SAP code lies with the person who is giving you the invoice. That means the primary responsibility lies with the supplier. This is as far as the invoice is concerned. And subsequently, we have to adopt the rate what is given by him. But then, if there is a dispute, what do we do? If there is a dispute, railways and the person who is giving the HSN code or the SAC code, then how do we go about it? How we can get the resolution for such things? That's a concept of advanced rulings in DST. So that is also one concept which is available. So all of you, what you can do is you can just tap into the net and ask for what is advanced ruling. If you have more interest in it, please ping to me. I will give you all the details on advanced ruling. Now, further, let me take you to the next basic concept. See, in the pre-GST, GST coupled form tax, goods and services tax. In the pre-GST period, what has happened is, you had different types of treatment for goods, and different treatment for services. When you have brought both the elements into the same area, that means you have brought both into a single taxation, what has happened is you have created a combination of supply of goods and services. Then what is the rate when you have a combination of supply and services in two different areas? Then what will happen? Don't you think if you have a combination of two different HSN codes, you will, if they are having different rates, for instance, if you have Portland cement and sleepers, you have different rates. 18% for Portland cement and 28% for 18% for sleepers and 28% for Portland cement. If you have the combination of these being supplied, then what happens? You have two different HSN codes and two different rates. They are supplied together. Then which rate you want to charge? This is where a new concept which has been introduced, and that is called composite and mixed supplies. Jahan pe bhi aapka goods or services, ya goods or goods combination mein jab bhi supply hota hai, they will come under the category of composite and mixed supplies. How is it useful for how is it useful in railways as such? You have to remember that at the time of tendering itself, at the time of preparing for issuing of tender itself, we have to take into consideration these aspects because huge costs are involved. GST rates are ranging from 0 to 28% plus cess also. So what has happened? You have got a huge cost which is there. When you have such a huge cost in GST, which can actually determine whether a particular supplier is quoting a correct rate or not, don't you think it will cause a lot of rate variation because of just the composite and mix-up supplies? If we understand that concept, then it becomes very easy. Just like how we have stated here, composite supply means goods plus goods or services. When you have different codes which are naturally bundled, I use the word naturally bundled here, please note that very carefully. In such cases where natural bundling is there, where natural, yahan pe natural bundling hota hai, wahan pe predominant supply jiska hai, wahi rate apply hoga. Predominant supply jiska hai, wahi rate apply hoga. That's the most important. operations. So what is the rate which you have to charge here? Please note, we have done a small exercise here. We found that 70% of the total supply made in supply of ballast, we found the predominant supply is the ballast material. And the ballast material is to be charged at 5%. Therefore, the Railway Board has issued a circular stating that the ballast cases, the GST rate applicable will be only 5%. And for the other, adopted is this composite supply concept, which is given in section 2, subclause 30 of GST. This particular concept can be used in various areas, but we have to ensure that there is natural bundling in these cases. Only in the such cases, we can adopt this particular principle. Now, let me go to another concept, that is the second concept, which is goods plus goods and services which are not naturally bundled. In such cases, the GST rate applicable will be the highest of any of the constituents of that particular supply. And what is this example which we can remember here? An assortment of biscuits, both are different types of biscuits, a factory like a Britannia company, Bechra. When they are selling this, one type of biscuit which is 5%, the other one is of 18%, one more is of 28%. You have a combination of all these things which are brought together and a single supply is being made. In these cases, the highest rate applicable to such this supply will become applicable to the entire piece, entire assortment of biscuits. So, this is called mixed supply. In railways, I found very few areas where we can apply this mixed supply. But the question which will arise in all the in the minds of everybody, each one of us, हम लोगों को सब लोगों को एक doubt आएगा, जैसे आप बता रहे natural bundling, natural bundling. अब natural bundling कैसा identify कर सकेंगे? तो सबसे simple example है, last of supply of last में ले लेंगे एक example. Now हम लोग unloading और loading operations को निकाल के last का supply खत्म कर सकेंगे? Can we do it? I don't think we can complete the supply of ballast by just removing the unloading and loading operations. Or let us say you remove transportation from it. Is the supply of ballast complete by when you are removing transportation also? I don't think it's impossible. You just can't remove any single element and complete the entire supply. So that is why it is called natural bundling test. You have applied what is called the natural bundling. एक constituent को उसको निकाल के आप segregate करके you are testing whether that is that the supply is a composite supply or not. Whenever you find that you cannot remove any single part and complete the supply, you have to categorize that as a composite supply. If you can segregate it, then you have to call it a mixed supply. This is the methodology which is adopted for identifying composite and mixed supplies. Huge savings can be brought if these principles are adopted, and we can actually save a huge money in contract management in this particular area. Okay, let me go to the next slide. Now, when GST was introduced, biggest problem which all of us faced was the GSTIN. GSTIN number कैसा पता चलेगा? क्या problem है उसमें? कैसे identify करेंगे? All these problems we have seen. Now, what is the structure of the GSTIN number? How is it allotted? It is actually a 15-digit code. The first two digits, all of us know already. We have been working on GST for the past three or four years virtually, and now the first two digits denote the state. The next 10 digits denote the PAN number. The 13th digit, please note here, when I say 13th digit, I am talking about this one in this particular case, which example which I have given here. Actually, the Ministry of Railways, Telangana State's this money to government after collecting it from the various recipients of service we are rendering. That means railways are both a tax deductor as well as a taxpayer. Like in CBIC, there is a CBDT and a Central Board of Direct Taxes. If you go Income Tax Department ka website, उस वेबसाइट का हमें चेक करें तो वो लोग उनका रजिस्ट्रेशन टैक्स डायरेक्टर के रूप में होगा. सो लाइक दिस यू विल बी हैविंग वेरियस टाइप्स ऑफ जीएसटीआईएन नंबर विल डिफर व्हेन इट कम्स टू द 14th कैटेगरी 14th डिजिट. देन यू हैव द 15th डिजिट व्हिच इज अ रैंडम नंबर. नाउ जीएसटीआईएन नंबर के साथ हम लोग क्या करते हैं, what happens is the you identify who that person is and you identify whether the person has given the correct GSTIN number or not. If correct GSTIN number nahi diye to kya hoga, first thing is we will not be able to pay out tax liability for that person because we have to upload all the invoices into the GSTN. So wo nahi hoga. Agar aap bill pay kar rahe kisi ka aur GSTIN number aap galat diye apne party master mein, then what happens? The minute you give the wrong GSTIN number, it will not. We will not be able to pay the tax credit for that particular transaction because you will not have what is called the reconciliation of the invoices which are there. Now, all these things have what they have done. They have really laid the emphasis on the GSTIN number. Now, how can you verify whether the correct GSTIN number has been given? GSTN number link to IPAS mein bhi aa gaya hai. Iske upar bhi aap, you want to verify the correctness of that, I have given you the website there. You need to just go there and feed in the GSTN number. You will get the type of transactions, I mean type of taxpayers they are, the name and all these particulars are available in this particular website. उनको पासवर्ड कुछ देने की जरूरत नहीं है, खाली उसको उसमें फीड करके GSTN नंबर का डिटेल्स दिए, नंबर आता है वो नंबर फीड करे तो इमीडिएटली यू विल बी एबल टू आइडेंटिफाई द टाइप ऑफ सप्लायर इज एंड द नेम ऑफ द सप्लायर. सो द GSTN नंबर यू विल बी गेटिंग वंस दिस इज करेक्टली फाइंड, बिलीव मी हाफ द प्रॉब्लम इज सॉल्वड इन जीएसटी. नेक्स्ट वन इज fundamental which we have to understand in GST is the type of suppliers. In the type of suppliers, if you look at it, you have three types of suppliers who are there. One, you have a regular taxpayer. Regular taxpayer kya hota hai, normal taxpayer hai wo, and uska jo GST rates hote hai na, it starts from 0 to 28. Kuch aise taxpayer bhi hai jo cess levy karte hai, लग्जरी आइटम्स के लिए सस्ती लेवी होता है एंड ओवर एंड अबाउट 28% यू विल बी हैविंग सेस. नाउ रेगुलर टैक्सपेयर जब होता है ना, ही क्रिएट्स व्हाट इज कॉल्ड अ टैक्स इनवॉइस, ही जनरेट्स व्हाट इज कॉल्ड अ टैक्स इनवॉइस. नाउ आर वी रेगुलर टैक्सपेयर्स? यस जेंटलमैन, रेलवेज में वी आर regular taxpayers. These are the types of suppliers. Please note very carefully the types of suppliers. Mane, hum log jab party master mein jaake fill karte hai na, you have to be very careful about GSTIN number. Kaun sa taxpayer hai ye? You have to identify that. Once you identify what is the type of tax taxpayer he is, you can feed that information there and you can verify what type of documents he has to submit. Then you have the second type of taxpayer who is called a composition taxpayer. He comes with that. This person, these people are those suppliers who have availed a discounted rate of GST. You know, discount market government say कि हम लोग उतना ज्यादा turnover नहीं है हमारा, to please reduce the GST rate. And the turnover threshold for a composition taxpayer is 1.5 crores for the supply of goods, and for the supply of service, the composition taxpayer the threshold is 50 lakh. The point to be noted when it comes to composition taxpayer is he will not actually be tax और सप्लाई और कोच को ये दिया मैंने। थ्रेशोल्ड तो हम ऑलरेडी बता चुके हैं कि 1.5 करोड़ है। नाउ दिस 1% क्या होता है? सीजीएसटी एसजीएसटी है 0.5% और सप्लाई ऑफ गुड्स पर सप्लाई ऑफ सर्विसेज 0.3% और 3% सीजीएसटी 3% और एसजीएसटी 3% ये लोग पे करते हैं। लेकिन आर दीस पीपल अलाउड टू टेक दिस मनी फ्रॉम अस व्हेन दे आर सप्लाइंग मटेरियल टू वेंडर्स? नो, दे आर नॉट अलाउड टू टेक दिस मनी। दे कैन नॉट इंक्लूड दिस टैक्स इन द बिल ऑफ सप्लाई। दीस क्वेश्चंस विल कम स्पेशली व्हेन फाइनलाइजिंग ऑफ टेंडर्स आर कमिंग, स्पेशली स्मॉल टेंडर्स जैसे व्हीकल कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स आर देयर, दैट इज वेयर दिस इश्यू कम्स इन। कंपोजिशन सप्लायर है whether he can include his tax in that bill of supply and give it to us. No, he cannot do it. He can only give a bill of supply without the tax. So the third category is...
Sir, 1 minute, sir. Hello, sir. Yeah. Sir, bill of supply can consider to pass the bill, sir?
Yeah, your bill of supply, you have to choose a bill of supply. Amino, who is speaking actually?
Sir, I am Prabhakar from Southeastern Railway X2 section. I am working, sir.
Yeah.
We receiving in impressed and all, they are giving bill of supply bill, sir. Can we consider that one, sir?
You're now impressed, you are passing it and you have to take a bill of supply only.
No, sir, their tax bills are coming, cash bills are receiving, sir, all types of bills are coming. We are passing a non-GST mode.
Mr. Prabhakar, you may segregate the bills into the regular taxpayers and the bill of supply providers, because you will have unregistered supplies also in interest bills, right?
Yes, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir, correct.
So you may have to segregate it and then upload it, okay?
We can, no problem, sir, can we?
No, don't have a problem with that.
Yes, sir, yes, sir. Because right now we are not considering, sir, that we got doubt.
We have to segregate. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Now, when it comes to the unregistered suppliers, then unregistered suppliers, I give you the threshold limit here. For the supply of goods, it is 40 lakhs. Money, the turnover limit should not cross 40 lakhs. Here I have not mentioned turnover. Turnover of the supplier should not cross 40 lakhs. The minute this limit crosses 40 lakhs, automatically he has to apply for registration. And in supplier of services, 20 lakhs threshold for current or current, he has to apply for registration. This is what you will find that most of them, many suppliers are unregistered and they will give a bill of supply only. Bill of supply only they will give. They will not give what is called a tax invoice. We don't have to pay any tax. And 90% of such bills we must be passing in non-GST bills. That is how we will be passing it in IPAS. Once we noted GST will not be paid to composition taxpayer and unregistered suppliers. Please, any doubts in this regard, we will take it at the last end of this session. And I think 15-20 minutes we will devote to pure clarifications, whatever are there, right? Now, this is a question which is often repeated. Every few days we keep getting such questions. What are the various types of supplies for which the GST is to be levied by railways? Isn't that every type of supply we have to pay GST? Everyone, please note very carefully, unless expressly exempt in the various notifications, on all supplies which are credited to units in railways, GST is leviable. This is the point which we have to keep in mind. And if we do not levy GST, then we may have to pay subsequently along with interest from the rate when in which that amount becomes due. On this subject, recently there has been a huge discussion on liquidity damages and penalties. This is what I was referring to you to when we were talking about the GST part, when we talked about IPAS inclusion also in the list of systems which are there for output tax liability. Many people have asked me, suppose we have made some deductions from security deposit which is being refunded for penalties to be levied on capping contractors and other type of contractors. Is that subject to GST? I have to tell you that definitely that is subject to GST, because we are transferring it to earnings of railways and we have to also issue an invoice for it. We may have to issue an invoice. Please consider here very carefully also this discussion we will have once again when we are going to the type of charges which we are having, forward charge and reverse charge. We will discuss that aspect also. And liquidated damages by GST, people have asked me this question, definitely it is applicable. There are so many judgments which have been given in the recent past on liquidated damages also. And clarifications have been issued by our headquarters office to the various units on this subject also. Therefore, it is, I am trying to clear the doubts on this. Whenever we transfer any amount to revenue other than those which have been expressly exempt in the notifications and in the Act, GST is payable. GST Act has not given any leeway for us to say this is not chargeable to GST. It could be exemption in here. And how do we implement it? We have to use our systems which are there with us, and we have to generate invoices also wherever necessary, and we have to give the details to the supplier also. For instance, in liquidated damages, a question will come, how are we going to reflect this in our in the GCM? Offline ability make invoice generation operator. It can be in the form of reverse charge, because liquidated damages is coming under most supplies which railways are made, which doesn't fall under the category of forward charge mechanism, it will come under reverse charge. So you may have to generate an invoice in the crisp manual ability at present, so that the liquidated damages are realized by railways without the GST element, possibly which we may have to pay to the other suppliers. We have issued circulars on this particular matter. Let me take up questions at the end. I'm sure this will come on this subject. Now, to simplify, why is this so very important, time of supply? Please note, when are we due to pay tax to the government? When are we due to pay the tax to the government? When is the instance of the tax assessing? To put it in a very nutshell, I try to simplify and they come to a conclusion that either the of the supply or the supply or the date of tax invoice, which is earlier of the two, will be applicable for goods or services in the date of tax invoice. Section 12 and 13 of CGST Act very clearly give you these particulars as to where and how you have to charge. But to sum up, these two are the major points which you have to remember. Goods ke liye date of payment, earlier date coincide date. And we have to also see what is the date of the tax invoice, whichever is earlier. That date we have to take into consideration for the purpose of goods. When it comes to the invoices. It is the date of tax invoice. Now, why is this very important? Value of transaction. What sort of questions are next? See, somebody has asked me, you made 90% of the contract value. And 10% we have maintained. But how should we take the transaction value? If you take the amount which is being paid, excluding the GST part, once you take it, that's the transaction value. That is what has been given in Section 15 of CGST Act. I'm giving you the references because people who are noting down the references, you can just go to the Act and check it for yourself and how it is that it becomes applicable. Then you have one point to be noted here is refundable deposits are outside the money of GST. Please note this point very carefully because security deposits, money, EMDs, EMD anyway is getting subsumed into GST. But any refundable deposit which we are getting, it is outside the money of GST. No GST needs to be taken on this. It is not included in the definition of contribution tax. Now, another question which has come up recently is, do we levy any GST on advances which we have received for the supply of goods? No GST is levyable on advances received for supply of goods. And have you account for it? This is another question which you which arises always. See, when we look at the time of supply, when it is advances received, you have to say that the amount has already been received, but the invoice has been included there, and it is accountable on the day the invoice is received. The payment has been received earlier, long back, but the supply has been dealt with. In the tax invoice today, as on the date of supply, which has been made. Against that, please note this point, there is a difference in the time of supply for this advances for supply of goods. When it comes to advances received for supply of services, you have to levy it right at the time when you are receiving the advances. At the time when you have received the advances itself, GST is levyable. What we do is actually the practical part of the transaction is when the filing of the returns takes place, we include the advances which we have received along with GST into the table 11A of GSTR1. And I'll talk to you about GSTR1 later. In table 11A, we will be adding it up. And in thirdly, the adjustment which is being made against the supply of services, the adjustments take place there. So what has happened is the advances which we are receiving from the supply of service, GST is applied at the time of receipt. This is the difference which we have to very carefully. Then let me go to the next slide. The type of charges. Gentlemen, this is another area where everybody keeps getting doubts and the clarifications are there here. Forward charge and reverse charge. Forward charge or reverse charge. What is this? Forward charge means we supplier to supply karega, tax is paid by the supplier only. What does it mean? The supplier will actually raise the tax invoice. The supplier will raise the tax invoice. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank
you very much.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to say that I am not audible. I just wanted the clarification. Fine. Now, the forward charge mechanism may show the tax invoice account raised
inspection service, the clearing house that is coming on, and the forward charge. Forward charge is forward charge money, paisa hum log vasool karenge aur government ko jama kar denge. That is the meaning of forward charge. When it comes to reverse charge, reverse kya hota hai? Forward ka reverse. Money, yahan pe supplier jo hota hai, he has actually paid the tax after collecting it from the customer or the recipient. But here in reverse charge, the recipient he pay karega. This question is there in many people's minds. Why they should do it? Actually, what happens is the act itself, it's been stated that if people, the person issuing the tax invoice becomes responsible for maintenance of books for a period of 7 years, apart from the financial year in which the transaction has taken place. And tax burden jo hota hai na, shift ho gaya hai. Forward charge mein kiska burden hai? Supplier ka burden. Tax burden is on the supplier. When it comes to the reverse charge, the tax burden is shifted from the supplier to the recipient. Moving the tax burden is part of the reverse charge. The notifications have themselves very clearly pointed out and clarified that railways ke transportation sivai ke transportation service ko chhod ke every other service rendered to railways by railways will come under the reverse charge. This is a big boon to us. We have to use it. Mane, aap pooch sakte hain, charges vasool kar rahe hain aap log? इसका टैक्स कौन बनना है? रेसिपिएंट बनना है. तुरंत आप लोग इमीडिएटली क्वेश्चन पूछेंगे साहब, हम लोग उनको बताया तो वो लोग टैक्स नहीं करेंगे ना. वी आर टेलिंग दैट यू हैव टू रेमिट इट ऑन रिवर्स चार्ज बेसिस. हाउ आर यू गोइंग टू हाउ आर यू गोइंग टू इंश्योर दैट ही इज पेइंग दैट अमाउंट. Now, people who are working in stores areas where scrap sales are there, we will also be noting that definitely the scrap sales will come under reverse charge. They have to pay the amounts. How are they? How are we ensuring that they are giving this money to the government? It is by another mechanism where we record in our GSTR1 itself. Another column 4B. There is a column 4B in GSTR1 wherein all the outward supplies which come under reverse charge, wherein we are not responsible, the tax invoice and the details of all the particulars are recorded by us. So, when we issue any tax invoice for offline reviewing, choose in the column number 13.5 that this particular transaction is to be recorded on reverse charge basis.
Please give the example, sir.
Yeah.
Please give the example.
Variant charges, license fees collected by our officers. Then you got number of examples, liquidated damages and penalties which are there, these are all to be charged only on reverse charge. Liquidated damages, they come under reverse charge provided these supplies are made to registered persons. Please note the difference. Very, very subtle difference is there. They will come under reverse charge provided the other person who is receiving the service is a registered person. If he is not a registered person, hum log forward charge pe hi vasool kar rahe hain. Jaise license fees hum log vasool kar rahe hain. Wo dusra aadmi jo hai wo registered nahi hai, unregistered person hai. To wo kahan se bharega? Government usko bharo bolte
sir. This reverse charges other than transportation service means what, sir?
That's what I'm saying. Anything which is other than the transportation service. For instance, we are collecting various charges.
In one AMC, we are for transportation service, we are doing an RCM basis, sir, same reverse charge mechanism, sir.
AMC for transportation service?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
AMC for transportation service, I did not get the meaning of it.
No, sir, one AMC is a lorry transportation service, one annual maintenance service contract, sir.
Okay.
In that agreement itself, they mentioned that reverse charge mechanism.
Are they remitting this amount to railways?
No, sir. It's going to party. Recipient taking two bags, sir.
Road and road transport.
This is outward supply.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
This is outward supply. What I am referring to is outward supply.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Inward supplies.
Yes, sir.
You are talking about lorry services which are rendered to railways. Right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
About the lorry services which are rendered to railways.
Yes, sir.
Is it again, you have to please understand here, there is a difference between a normal contract and a contract which comes under what is called an ATA.
Yes, sir.
Agency.
Yes, sir.
It is coming under Goods Transportation Agency. Please note, for railways, they should not charge any GST. It is coming under the exempt category.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Please note this very carefully. Even reverse charge is wrong.
But it has been shown in the agreement itself, sir. It has been.
What clarification you are asking in? May know which railway you are from?
SWR, sir. Southwestern Railway, sir.
Southwestern Railway.
Bangalore Division, sir.
Do one thing. Just send me a mail. I have any email address at the end of this presentation.
Yes, sir.
You can send me a mail and send you the circular as well as the details to you so that you can go through that and based upon it take your action whatever you want in your.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Now, this forward charge and reverse charge, it is actually a case where we do not understand what is forward charge and what is reverse charge. Either in OTL or in input tax, this will create a lot of problems. For instance, recently we had a problem in one particular unit which has actually marked one transaction which should have been marked under forward charge and the reverse charge. Invoice to issue kya gaya hai, they have correctly issued it under forward charge. But we have accounted it in IPAS in under reverse charge. So what has happened? When we paid the tax, we paid it under reverse charge and that amount we have actually claimed it back as IT stores. So what has happened? Government put nil ho gaya. We have not paid any amounts to the party owns. Because under reverse charge, we become responsible for inward supplies also. Inward supplies made under reverse charge means normal of responsibility. कि आपका जो सप्लाई है इनवर्ट सप्लाई है और रिवर्स चार्ज हम लोग रिसिपिएंट है इसीलिए हम लोग टैक्स भरेंगे बोल के हम लोग भरे और उसका इनपुट टैक्स कटेंगे हम लोग नहीं करेंगे तो ये नेट इफेक्ट क्या हो गया गवर्नमेंट उसके वजह से वी हैड टू पे इंटरेस्ट एट द रेट ऑफ 18% सी व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू पॉइंट आउट इज इफ अ मिस्टेक इज कमिटेड इवन इन यूजिंग द टाइप चार्ज व्हेन वी आर पोस्टिंग इन आईपास it can result in wrong payment of tax. So please understand, when supplies are made, what I have referred to here in this transportation is, in this particular PPT is that it is outward supplies. When it comes to inward supplies, please note most of the supplies which are made, they are under forward charge only. Very few items are there where the reverse charge is mentioned for inward supplies. But for outward supplies, major issues have come and please mark it correctly. Forward charge will mark karna hai. And for outward supplies, inward supplies, definitely forward charge jada hai. So we don't have any, very few items are there under reverse charge. topic. Important topic is input tax credit lagging. ऐसा एरिया है जहां हम लोग कितने बार भी सुने इसमें डाउट आते रहता है. लेट अस जस्ट गो टू देम. T1, T2, T3, T4 एंड C2. नॉन बिजनेस कैटेगरी हम लोग सब समझते हैं. आज आजकल तो कोविड का टाइम है. यू विल फाइंड मेडिकल बिल्स और कॉम्पिटिशन बिल्स पूरा बहुत ज्यादा बढ़ रहे हैं. उसमें GST बिल्स भी होंगे. When we are passing such bills, they have to mark only T1 because they are not a part of our business operations. So, जो भी expenditure हम लोग medical supplies के लिए करते हैं and for the railway schools and colleges maintenance, these expenditures have to be brought under the non-business category and they have to be marked under T1. ये bypass में भी बहुत clear है. Please mark T1 for such and general के लिए आप check करें तो demand number level में जब भी expenditure होता है it comes under the category of this. Watch it out very carefully. Demand number level specific allocation आप check करें तो you will find that you have to mark it as T1. The second doubt which many people have raised even in sessions which earlier also I have seen that goods in the case of railways, we are not allowed to claim input tax credit. We are not allowed to claim input tax credit because we are rendering services at the rate of 5%. And since we have been expressly been told not to claim credit, we have to mark it under T2 only. Now, what is this restricted credits? See, and this is the, I think in this entire presentation, this is the only section which I have mentioned. Therefore, you can understand the importance of this particular section. Section 17.5 of CGST Act has listed out a number of items which will come into this category. Mainly, in the case of railways, if you look at it, works contracts which are relating to buildings and bridges, they will come under the category of restricted credits. Other works contracts which are not directly related to civil structures like buildings and bridges will come under the category of C2. Now, you have another category where we are eligible, fully eligible for what gum items I just made. What items will be to T4 category may I get? T4 category may actually you can say that prior to COVID period we were running so many linen contracts specially meant for AC coaches, AC trains, fully AC trains. For instance, you have Rajdhani Express, then you have your Shatabdi and all these special trains which are fully air conditioned, where GST is levyable, such contracts will come under the T4 category. And if you have some onboard housekeeping services also for such trains, they will come under T4 category. What gum items? And T4 category is coming, how to identify that item is coming under T4? The entire should have been incurred towards fully taxable services. Expenditure should have been incurred towards fully taxable services. Mane our outward supply be fully taxable. Then that means you are matching here your inward supplies to your outward supplies. Are simply aapka outward supplies ka one in the notification is only for transportation service. But suppose we are making supplies, open supply of goods itself to RNL or any other organization, we are eligible for the input tax credit, 100% input tax credit. That's why we have to mark it as import. And we should claim that much of input tax credit from the output tax liabilities which we are paying. This we have to be very careful, because generally all the goods supplied in case of railways will definitely come under the category of exempt supplies, that is TV. But then, when a part of the supplies which railways have received, for instance, cement sleepers, then, we have received sleepers from RVNL. So, to the extent the supplies have been made to RVNL, the input tax which we have paid to the factories, we become eligible for input tax credit. And it comes under the category of import. So the segregation has to be done very carefully, and we should take input tax credit for such transactions. Now, before I actually take you to the rest of the slides, I thought I need to show you the important websites here. Many of you working on GST cells will be knowing these websites. But for those who have not seen the websites, please go to these websites. cbic.gov.in will give you the entire rate list and all the clarifications what you need for the purpose of implementing GST in railways. You are available here. Then even the e-flyers are very clearly available here. And then you have an operative wing. I mean, I've already given the same website to you earlier also, wherein the GST returns are filed and all the details are given there. That website is www.gst.gov.in. And our Indian Railway website, Accounts Directorate, actually we have issued so many circulars on GST. I think they have done a wonderful job on this implementation of GST. Because every aspect has been taken care of in this particular website. So many clarifications have been issued by our railway board, and they are available at this particular website, that is indianrailway.gov.in. And one of the most important innovations throughout in Indian Railways was the introduction of this manual utility. Actually, this particular innovation has led to capturing of all the data which was in the manual mode. For instance, your MCRs which were issued in the tax office for the collection of bailiff charges or security deposits or any advances paid were all accounted in only one system, and that is your Chris manual entity. And that link is available here. On this particular website, it's of course only has to be issued, but you must not be able to access this website. You can ask your GST cell of your headquarters to provide you an ID for generating an invoice. And it is very important to note here that the link to the ASP of CRIS, that is the application support provider, support provider is Velocis.
Hello.
And this Velocis link is also there in this particular website. So that is this is a very, very important website. So I just thought of these four websites are there. And please note here, cbic.gov.in is the primary source of data. I would like to point out here that you can refer to any other websites also, like TRIA Tax and all those things. But those are not primary sources. And the data which is provided in cbic.gov.in is current and correct. Please go to this website for getting any clarification. months. Let me put the next slide. Next most important area which I thought I need to speak upon is your TDS deductible tax source. This was introduced in the year 2019, October 2019, and the 2% is deducted for every transaction wherever the transaction value of the transaction is less, greater than 2.5 lakhs. Now, a question might arise if composition suppliers are there whose supply is more than 2.5 lakhs, we have to deduct GST on that. Note here that wherever you have composition supplies which are made beyond 2.5 lakhs, the 2.5 lakhs limit has been mentioned, we have to deduct the 2% also. But it's a point to note here that the GST rate for the composition supplier is only 1%, while the TDS is of 2%. I can't, how can we term it as TDS? This contradiction is there in GST, so this deduction has to be made. In IPAS, there is a particular point to be noted. Recently, we have seen cases where interstate supplies have been recorded for even composition suppliers. The point to note here is composition suppliers who are making interstate supplies are no longer composition suppliers. They have to exit that scheme and get themselves registered under regular taxpayers. Therefore, such supplies which have been made will be rejected by IPAS also. And we cannot account these transactions in GSTN also because interstate supplies are not allowed to be made by composition suppliers. Let me take you to the next important aspect. Recently, all of us have been struggling while passing bills. The reason is declaration needs to be uploaded in IPAS for suppliers whose turnover is lesser than 50 crores. This limit has come from 1/4/2021, and this limit, if a person is having an annual turnover greater than 50 crores, please note here, this annual turnover is an aggregate annual turnover. Aggregate annual turnover includes exempt supplies made by the party also. That's a point which is being disputed by many people. This aspect we have to keep in mind when we are looking at the annual turnover certificate. Of course, if the chartered accountant provides for the certificate, that is the responsibility of the chartered accountant to take care of that particular aspect. Now, e-invoicing is applicable to any person whose turnover is beyond 50 crores. And whenever a supplier is saying that his turnover is less than 50 crores, then obviously he has to provide a declaration, and that declaration needs to be uploaded into IPAS, and only on uploading we can pass the bills subsequently. And a small note on various returns filed. I was referring to many returns. One reference which I made was of DSTR1, this relates to output tax liability. The target date for this particular return is 11th of every month. And DSTR3B is the return which we file on 20th of every month. I think today is 20th. We have already filed for the states of Telangana and AP. Most of the other states also. I have seen in the group that many of the railways have already filed this particular return. And this is the return wherein we claim the income tax credit also. And this is the return wherein we can even check whether every income tax credit has come into account, has been dropped account or not. And any adjustment to be made needs to be made only in this GSTR. If you have an annual return apart from GSTR 1 and 3B, annual return target date, originally prescribed in the Act is 31st of December of that need to handle the trucks. And one point to be noted here is railways are not necessitated by acts and the notifications to submit a form called GSTR-C, wherein the charter accountant needs to give the clarification and certification. We are not necessitated because our returns, our accounts are certified by CE. And we, monthly we submit another return which is called GSTR-7, which is nothing but a compilation of all the expenditure which we have incurred, where we have recovered the TDS. This amount needs to be uploaded by death of the subsequent month. Every month we have to uploaded this. Now, this is as far as returns to be filed. And this is a simple presentation which I have done. I'm getting my phone number. Now, I'll take questions from all of you.
The meaning of GSTR 2A details, sir? Meaning?
GSTR 2A is nothing but the GSTR 1 is a return which is filed by the supplier. And GSTR 2A is the reverse of GSTR 1. All the supplies which have been accounted in GSTR 1 are reflected in GSTR 2A.
Because we are passing in BSNL bill, sir. This problem we are facing, sir. That's
why. Yeah, BSNL may count. What happens is, what we do is, we include all the bills together and we pass one particular number, right?
Yes, sir, yes, sir. Different numbers, sir. Different numbers, sir.
You are not segregating individually.
Yes, sir.
You're not segregating individually in uploading it into IPAS.
No, sir. Whatever bills received in the IPAS we are passing, sir. There we are passing.
What is
it? GSTR 2A, but it is not available. Not available, sir.
No, what I am saying? Hello?
Yes, sir. Tell, sir.
What it is, in BSNL bills, what we do is we pass a consolidated We create, the executive actually what he does is, he does not actually segregate the individual invoices. The whole thing they put it. Whereas BSNL what it does is they upload the returns in a segregated manner. So we will not be able to link up this particular both these invoices. You will not be able to link up. That's
it. Hello.
Yeah.
If JM bill pass karte hain, to usme bhi har baar invoice upload karne ke liye option aata hai, jabki party khud upload karta hai. To ye GST ka hi invoice upload karne ki baat kyun ye bataya tha? 15 crore, 100 crore.
Passing
of GM bills. GM bills, the uploading problem to be issued.
मेडिकल बिल जो पुट अप करते हैं उसमें क्या जीएसटी अलग-अलग बाइफरकेशन करके लिखना चाहिए या इंक्लूडिंग जीएसटी जैसे सीजीएसटी एसजीएसटी आईटी चार्ज टीडीएस इस तरह का बना के कि सर केवल जीएसटी और एसजीएसटी लिख के ही वो बिल एक्सपेंडिचर को पुट अप करना चाहिए जी सर आईटी चार्ज क्या होता है सर हां आईटी चार्ज भी वो होता है सर आईटी चार्ज आईटी सर इनकम टैक्स
2%
2% 2% है यार 2% फॉर एनी कंपनी एंड 1% फॉर अदर देन कंपनी
ओके सर, थैंक यू सर।
सर दिस रिगार्डिंग जीएसटी और प्ले सर रिक्लेरिफिकेशन।
या दैट्स व्हाट आई एम सेइंग, इट इज द रिवर्स ऑफ जीएसटीआर 1। व्हाट दिस व्हेनेवर जीएसटीआर 2 इज फाइल्ड बाय अ पर्सन, व्हेन जीएसटीआर 2 इज फाइल्ड बाय अ पर्सन,
यस सर,
व्हाट हैपेंस जीएसटीआर 1 इज फाइल्ड बाय अ पर्सन, दैट सेम थिंग विल बी रिफ्लेक्टेड इन जीएसटीआर 2। Let us say the person, what has happened here is the person has filed his GSTR 1 and the GSTR number is reflected there, and the same GSTIN number uske account mein jaake it will reflect the same invoice number.
But we are facing problem here, we are not seeing the GSTR 2A particular set while passing the bill.
If we don't see the GSTR 2A particulars, what will happen?
No, we can auto pass the bill, sir. That GSTR 2A particulars are not visible, sir, because their invoice number is not visible.
See, GSTR 2A particulars which are uploaded in IMAS are based upon what is called the GSTR 2B form.
Yes, sir.
Uploaded by the Velocis team. In the by seeing the previous month 11 ke baad jo to be upload hua uske aadhar pe, but then there is another form called GSTR 2A,
yes sir,
which is a dynamic form. When you look at that dynamic form, what happens is the entire that dynamic form itself will give you the correct position as on that day.
Yes sir, yes sir.
It is not being reflected in
automatically downloaded. And this is an e-invoice bill, sir.
If it is an e-invoice bill, you should not have a problem at all.
E-invoice bill not visible, that the GSTR 2A particular, sir. There is a problem, sir.
E-invoice bill, that's what I'm saying. There's a time lag between the GSTR 2B and GSTR 2A.
Yes, sir.
This timeline might be the reason for your problem. Okay?
So, in that e-invoice bill, if GSTR 2A particular is not visible in our system, IPAS, we can able to clear the bill, sir. Not possible, no?
It's not possible. It's not possible. So, what you can do is you can ask your GST cell to provide the GSTR 2A particulars to you.
Yes, sir.
And then based on it, you can raise an SR and ask the CRIS people to resolve the issue. That's it.
Okay. Otherwise, it comes and execute, you can ask clarification now, sir.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, again, clear up. For what is charge in the reverse charge?
Yeah?
For what is charge in the reverse charge? Again, clear, sir.
Aapko doubt hai, uspe?
Yes, sir.
See, what is the forward charge? Forward charge, when can you take a transaction under forward charge? When the supplier has issued a tax invoice. Jab supplier tax invoice issue karega, or tax recipient se vasool karega. Mane, railway ka example le lijiye. Hum log jab transportation service karte hain, goods ka rail.
Hum log bolte hain na sir isko. इसको हम लोग सब चैट करता कि सर डीपीटी सेंट सर इसे बोलता है कि जूम चैट से आप डाउनलोड करिए बोलता है उसमें जूम चैट सर वो सब ऑप्शन हम लोग को हमको लगता है कि मोबाइल पर नहीं आता होगा हो सकता है लैपटॉप या कंप्यूटर में जो दिखता होगा ऑनलाइन से उसमें कहीं फाइल में कहीं दिखता होगा जूम
चैट आंसर क्लियर होने दीजिए दोस्तों
ऐसा लगता है
कभी
इसमें अटैच में
एक काम कीजिए जो भी क्लैरिफिकेशन आपको
रेसिपिएंट ऑफ द सर्विस, टैक्स के साथ पैसा वसूल कर लेगा। और जब टैक्स के साथ पैसा वसूल करेंगे, इसका रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी हो जाएगा पैसा जमा करने का, टैक्स जमा करने का। रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी लाइज विद दी सप्लायर, माने रेलवे में अगर ट्रांसपोर्टेशन सर्विस हम लोग करें तो तुरंत हम लोग क्या करेंगे, वी विल से दैट यू हैव बी इशू एन आर आर, कलेक्ट द अमाउंट फ्रॉम द सप्लायर, दैट इज हाउ वी विल गो अहेड। ओके, एंड रिवर्स चार्ज क्या होता है, उसका उल्टा है, रेसिपिएंट ही पैसा भरना पड़ेगा, लेकिन सप्लायर ही विल नॉट रेंडर द
उसकी डेट है, तो ये डेट क्या आर नोट से डेट से पहले होनी चाहिए या बाद में होनी चाहिए, जो जीएसटी इनवॉइस मतलब जो पहले जनरेट होना चाहिए या बाद में होना चाहिए।
Therefore, जो भी goods accept हो गए उसी के ऊपर वो लोग tax invoice raise कर रहे हैं, ठीक है?
मतलब बाद की date में भी acceptable है,
that's all this, okay? Because goods received on acceptance, there's a reason. Yeah, Shyam, Shyam ji.
Sir, lorry services में reverse charge?
Lorry services वही बात बताया आपको। लॉरी सर्विसेज को दो पार्ट कर सकते हैं आप। एक का GDA जो होता है, GDA माने गुड्स ट्रांसपोर्टेशन एजेंसी, यहाँ पे एक प्रिंसिपल इश्यू GDA सर्विसेज में रेलवे के लिए तो कुछ भी ये नहीं है, GST नहीं होता है, विच इज एग्जाम सर्विस फॉर रेलवे। Now when it comes to any other contract में आके GDA के बगैर दूसरा contract में आके आप generate कर रहे हैं, what you can do is will be able to you the GST rate applicable will become 18% there. GST rate will become 18% there. Such is the this is the mechanism. So I don't know in your case what is the actual rate which has been given in the contract.
Sir, GST bill passing के समय सभी GST number को check करना जरूरी है क्या?
जब party master में सबसे पहले आप entry कर रहे हैं, वो verify करके entry करो यार।
वो इसमें ये नहीं, मैंने कोई अगर मान लीजिए पार्टी का गलत जीएसटी नंबर दे रहा है तो वो तो
जब कब बिल आएगा
पार्टी मास्टर बन जाएगा तब।
हाँ, फिर क्या डाउट है
इसमें, ये जानना चाहिए तो पार्टी मास्टर
में कंफर्मेशन करते वक्त ही चेक करना चाहिए कि जीएसटी सही है या नहीं, वो रेलवे चेक कर लिए तो यू विल नेवर हैव अ प्रॉब्लम।
सर कभी कभी ऐसा होता है कि एक पार्टी मैंने पहले जीएसटी नंबर को ब्लॉक करके फिर दूसरा जीएसटी नंबर चालू करवा लेते हैं किसी दूसरे में, फिर ये पकड़ने में
लेटर ऑफिसर कंफर्मिंग द जीएसटीआईएन नंबर डी चेकिंग व्हाट इज द करेक्ट जीएसटीआईएन नंबर कैन डू इट हियर, दैट्स हाउ एग्जीक्यूटिव ऑफिसर को ही कंफर्म करना पड़ेगा ना
जी। पहले का जो जीएसटी था वो चालू था, उसके बाद कॉन्ट्रैक्टर ने उसको बंद करवा के न्यू जीएसटी दूसरा नंबर एक्सेप्ट करा
लिया।
रिफंड ऑफ जीएसटी ऑन डेमरेज चार्जेस।
Ravi Kumar Gara? Who has raised the question, please? Yeah, refund of GST on? On demurrage charges. Actually, the clarification which you sought for is an area of a big controversy, actually. The not controversy, I will not say controversy, but wherein provision has not been made in FOIS for refunding the GST collected on demurrage charges. See, we need to create what is called a credit note in the FOIS system for the purpose of generating refund of order on the GST. That is the problem area. And we have already written so many clarifications, I mean so many references, same reference has been made even to Northern Railway also, which is a nodal railway for FOIS. They have also written to CRIS for including this credit note creation in FOIS. But we are awaiting that to be implemented. It has not been implemented yet. That's the reason why we are not able to refund GST which has been collected in demurrage charges. Any other questions, please? Reverse charge example for outward supplies, any outward supply which has been made other than transportation service will come under reverse charge. See, for instance, your daily charges, your license fees which you have to collect, and you have penalties, liquidated damages, all these will come under reverse charge. Right? Any other questions?
Sir, reconcile of GST amount
increase.
Yeah? GST amount ka reconcile kaise hoga, to wo mane jitna katoti uske payment kiya
us sab GST ka 2A se, see jab GST ka 2A se aap link karenge automatic reconcile ho jayega. Jaise GST ka 2A mein invoice number ek hi hai, jo tax vasool kare borrower charge mein vasool kare wo sahi hai. Then you have your what they call your number of your invoice number matching, so you have date of invoice match, you have taxable value match, you have GST amount match, you have sub match, you have automatically pura transaction match, then it will become eligible for input tax credit. That is from GSTIN number, GST or 2A se match.
सर ये एक चीज बताइए, जो टैक्स इनवॉइस जो जनरेट होती है कंपनी से, तो वो जो GSTR का जो 2A फॉर्म होता है उसमें रिफ्लेक्ट होती है कि नहीं?
GSTR 2A फॉर्म में रिफ्लेक्ट होना चाहिए ना?
नहीं आ रहा सर, कोई आती है सर, कभी आती है कभी नहीं आती सर।
होगा बिकॉज आई गिव यू वन रीजन, जीएसटी में एक ऑटो आजकल व्हाट दे हैव डन इज GSTN में जो दिया गया है ना, GSTN में जो साइट है इट डज ऑटो रिकंसिलिएशन ऑफ इनवॉइसेस, और ई इनवॉइस जो होता है दैट इज ऑटोमेटिकली रिकंसाइल्ड इन GSTN इटसेल्फ, एंड आई थिंक दैट शुड बी, सिंस इट इज द again, there's no question of it not coming in GSTR. It should not be there. ठीक है मालूम मुकेश जी पक्का रहना चाहिए. See, मैं आपको बताया इसके पहले भी बताया कि e-invoice जो है
चंद्रभूषण आजाद
जिस दिन अपलोड हो गए
जो भी है बस भूषण आजाद
देयर आर टू टाइप्स ऑफ रिटर्न्स व्हिच आर प्रिपेयर्ड. वन इज कॉल्ड GSTR 2B एंड द सेकंड वन इज कॉल्ड GSTR 2A. GSTR 2A इज अ डायनामिक रिटर्न whereas GSTR 2B is generated after 11th or subsequent to the date of GSTR 1 being uploaded. So what will happen is there is a time lag between GSTR 2A and 2B. So we are keeping the information in IPAS on the basis of GSTR 2B and not 2A. जो डायनामिक रिपोर्ट है उसके वजह से ये डिफरेंस आ रहा है. दैट इज द रीजन फॉर दिस डिफरेंस इन ई इनवॉइसिंग. लेकिन ई इनवॉइसिंग आने के बाद आई हैव वेरी रेयरली हर्ड ऑफ मिसमैच. या एनीबडी एल्स?
हेलो.
या
सर नमस्ते. हेलो हेलो.
हाँ मिस्टर बलवंत सर.
हाँ हाँ सर नमस्ते सर. एक एक हमारा बिल था जिस जो पार्टी ने गलती से सर जो ट्रीट करते टाइम में रॉन्ग नंबर लिख दिया सर और एक्चुअली इनवॉइस नंबर दूसरा था.
एक्चुअली उसको ही कैन अमेंड द सेम इनवॉइस इन द इन हिज जीएसटी जीएसटीआर 1. उसको ही कैन अमेंड इट. ओके
हो जाएगा सर यहाँ पर.
हाँ उसका अमेंडमेंट कर सकता है. ही कैन डू इट.
नहीं सर वो चाह रहे हैं सर यहाँ से ऑलरेडी इसका दूसरा बिल लग गया सेम नंबर दूसरे रेलवे में वो सेम नंबर पे पास नहीं हो रहा आई पास में सर.
नहीं सही बात बता रहा हूँ आपको. जो भी सही नंबर है टू मेक द अमेंडमेंट एंड देन जीएसटीएन में जाके जीएसटीआर 1 ऑप्शन चूज करके टेबल नंबर 9A बोल के एक टेबल है उसमें जाके अमेंड कर सकता है. इनवॉइस नंबर अमेंड कर सकते हैं, ट्रांजैक्शन वैल्यू अमेंड कर सकते हैं, जीएसटी अमाउंट अमेंड कर सकते हैं, पूरा अमेंड कर सकते हैं, हर एक चीज अमेंड कर सकते हैं उसमें.
ओके सर रेक्टिफाई हो जाएगा उसमें आई पास में सिस्टम है.
आई पास में नहीं जीएसटीएन में अमेंड कर.
हां जीएसटीएन में.
जीएसटीएन में अमेंड करें तो ऑटोमेटिकली टू बी में आएगा. टू बी में आए तो हमारा आई पास में ये हो जाएगा.
जीएसटी इंक्लूड है सर रेट में एज पर पीओ. जीएसटी इंक्लूड रेट में और पार्टी सर जो इन्वेस्ट जारी करती है जीएसटी अलग से दिखाती है और उसको बेसिक को कम करके जीएसटी को अलग से शो करती है. जब बिल पास करते हैं तो हमें अब कैसे करना चाहिए सर?
वैसे ही करना है. सी फॉर इंस्टेंस ऑल वर्क्स कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स ऑल आर इंक्लूसिव कॉन्ट्रैक्ट बेसिस ना.
हां हां ओके सर.
पूरे के वर्क्स कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स पूरे इंक्लूसिव कॉन्ट्रैक्ट है.
हां हां
आपका वर्क्स कॉन्ट्रैक्ट जो 12% का है लेट मी अज्यूम दैट
स्टॉक आइटम है सर.
₹10 ये आपको अपने सिस्टम में भी यही बनना है. वो टैक्स इनवॉइस जो देता है ना.
हाँ सर
भी यही देना है. यू हैव टू गिव द सेम इंफॉर्मेशन टैक्स.
ठीक है सर वो उस पर ही जो टीडीएस काटेंगे सर टैक्सेबल अमाउंट पर काटेंगे जीएसटी को निकाल के. लेकिन सर आधार पार्टी क्या करती है सर वो इंक्लूडिंग जीएसटी दिखा करके और जीएसटी को शो नहीं करती है और फिर उसको ऐसे भी बिल पास हो जाते हैं एज पर पीओ इंक्लूडिंग जीएसटी है.
यू हैव टू
और इनवाइस में भी जीएसटी शो नहीं करती है सर वो, नो इंक्लूडिंग
सर। जैसे कि अभी इन्होंने जैसा बताया, एक सर हमारे यहाँ भी यही प्रॉब्लम आती है, जैसे पीओ में इंक्लूडिंग जीएसटी करते हैं वो, राइट सर, तो वो हम लोग जीएसटी न्यूट्रलाइज करके उसको जितने परसेंट जीएसटी होता है डिवाइड करके बेस वैल्यू और जीएसटी हम लोग ऐड करके पेमेंट कर देते हैं कंट्रीब्यूटर। लेकिन यदि फर्म वो कंपोजिशन स्कीम में रजिस्टर्ड है सर और इंक्लूडिंग जीएसटी लिखा हुआ है पीओ, तो सर उस केस में क्या करना चाहिए, क्या उसको जीएसटी उतना काट के पेमेंट करना चाहिए या जितना एज पर पीओ है हमें उतना पेमेंट कर देना चाहिए?
हेलो जी सर,
समझ गए ना?
हाँ इंक्लूडिंग है सर,
इंक्लूसिव कॉन्ट्रैक्ट में वी कैन नॉट पे मोर,
उसको पे नहीं करेंगे ना सर जीएसटी?
वी आर पेइंग अलोंग विद जीएसटी, सो ट्रांजैक्शन वाले को सेग्रीगेट करना है। अभी आई हैव गिवन यू द डिवीजन नो कैसा करना है बोल के, दैट अकॉर्डिंग टू द डिवीजन यू राइट।
हेलो,
या प्लीज,
वी आर पासिंग सप्लाई बिल्स विद द आईटीसी फ्लैग एस T3।
कौन सा सप्लायर्स?
नॉर्मल सप्लाई नॉनस्टॉप,
और
नॉनस्टॉप यूज, नॉनस्टॉप यूज।
देयर इज अ डिफरेंस व्हिच सी इफ यू इन T3 रिलेट्स टू व्हाट इज कॉल्ड रिस्ट्रिक्टिव सप्लाइज।
Yes.
And section 17.5 में जो listed है, only those items are coming under T3. The same has been listed out even in rule 42 of CGST rules. Please go to CGST rules also once and check it out for yourself. You will find that every item which is appearing, which has to be included in T3, is are those items only which are recorded in 17.5 has supply non-stock items हमारा उसमें नहीं figure होते हैं, they are different, so you have to include it in T2 rather than T3, right? Anybody else please?
Hello sir.
Yeah.
But our system will not allow, sir. Because if it's a B2B transaction, it only shows only, it actually only reverse charge.
Do one thing, I think in this contact list, we must take care of this.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
That would be the, because we have issued already here in Samsung.
No sir, after 1421 the system has, you know, the manageability portal has been changed a lot. Any B2B transaction accepts only, you know, it accepts only RCM, yes only, it does not accept anything.
You can just contact Mr. Anupur, because we have issued transactions for most of more than 20 crores.
Okay. Okay sir. Okay sir.
Yes sir, I'm available if any clarification required.
Yeah, good afternoon sir.
Good afternoon sir.
How are you?
Hello, I'm good sir.
Bye.
this is a goods transaction. Goods forward charge only.
Yeah, thank you, Venu.
What? It was RVNL he was asking. No?
Yeah, it's goods transaction.
Goods transaction is a forward charge. For services, it is reverse charge. For registered persons, this manual utility will not entertain there.
Yeah.
For goods, it will take.
Okay. I got your point. Thank you.
On behalf of Sitara, I thank Mr. Krishna Kumar for his wonderful lecture and clarifying doubts of various participants. Tomorrow, the login is at 11 o'clock. The topic for tomorrow is the changing role of PFAs. The speaker is Mr. A. Venkateshwar, retired MP and CMO. So, all are requested to log in at 11 o'clock. The session will start at 11:30 hours. Thank you, one and all.